The BMP Accelerator Program, which is a program basically set up to coach to help people to achieve their aim of becoming BMP certified. And we have a goal, the target we are having for the accelerator program is to have at least 50 persons become certified by this time next year. That's our target. And I'm sure most of us here, we are going to achieve that. If the seven of us, okay, somebody has stepped out again. If the seven of us on this call can do it, even before the end of this year, I'll be so glad it will be. I'll go and post on LinkedIn that, no, we did it. And I want to say it, that we can do it. In fact, that is the campaign that I'm on. This is the message that we can do it. We can all become PMP certified before the end of this year. And that is why one of the focus of today's meeting, that's one of the things I'm going to be emphasizing on today's meeting. I'm going to do a little bit of a conclusion on the slide. Yeah, on the aspect of the slide I was talking about in the video I sent earlier during the week. Then after that, we're not going to discussions that is not really book, as in what I mean, not really project management, a discussion around how we are going to achieve our goal. So the last thing we discussed, the last video, how many of us have gone through the video that I sent on Wednesday, the video and the slides? If you've gone through it, just say hi.
Hi.
Okay.
Hi.
Okay, good. So we stopped at the last slide we made. I talked about was the roles, which I talked about the sponsor, the project office, and the program manager as part of the roles in project management. The roles on a project. You know, we have a sponsor who's the person that is paying for the project, main guy that is, without him, the project is dead. Because he's not dropping the money. If there are no money to get acquire resources for the project cannot, no matter how good the project office or the project manager is, if there's no money, the project ends. And then the project enters into a phase that we call closing. So project sponsor, then we have the project office, which is the department that supports project management. I mean, the project managers, you know, it's like an office for supporting the activity that's going on in the field. You know, they serve as supporting role. They define the standards, they provide best practices, and they audit the project to make sure the project meets up with the standard of the client, of the government, in case the project has something to do with the government regulation, you know, and whichever the desires of the stakeholders are. The project management office makes sure that the project meets up. So, and they make sure that the project manager is working in line with the objectives of the project. So another thing, you know, the last role I talked about was the role of the project manager itself, which the project manager is responsible for the program. Sorry, the program manager, who is responsible for the program, coordinates, you know, several other projects. So I'm going to the next thing, which the next slide is about the context, project context, which is the context in which the project or it's executed. Let me remove my video here. Okay. So when we're talking about the project context, we are referring to the organizational environment where the project is being carried out. That is the situation surrounding the project itself. For instance, now, let's say Coca-Cola is a company. They have a project of installing a new machine. You know, and you are now coming in as a project manager to ensure that this new technology they are installing, you know, comes up successfully and is installed and everything about it. You know, the project is installation of a new technology, whatever the name of the technology is. But this project is happening within Nigerian Bottling Company. That's the parent name, Nigerian Bottling Company. So Nigerian Bottling Company is the organizational environment wherein the project is carried out. The name of the project is installation of a new technology. So the way the project will go will be determined by the kind of organization that Nigerian Bottling Company is. That is the way their structures, the kind of influence that they have, the environmental factor, the structure of the you know, the hierarchy, the organogram, the way everything happens in that Nigerian Bottling Company will determine the way this project will go. So that's what we mean by the project context. That is the environment within which the project is being executed. And this project context is determined by the organizational structure mostly. Why? Because it's in leadership, they will tell you everything rise and fall on the leader. The way the structure of the organization is will determine the way the project manager will execute the project. You determine the person you report to, you determine the things that you need to put in place. I remember back then when I was in Port Harcourt, I used to work with one oil and gas service company. Then one of our major contractors is Shell. And if you have any job to do within the Shell facilities, you have to follow strictly safety rules, the way Shell does their thing. Their standard, you have to follow it. I remember there was a time too, I was working one telecom company. We used to go to this place in LMS side, the FLT, the terminal. The terminal is being managed by Intel's, which is this Articles company. The way they set their standard in Intel's is quite different from the way they set their standard in Shell. The way we do our project in Shell, Intel's, is different from the way you do it within Shell property. For instance, when we go to Intel, when we want to do, Intel doesn't, they have, people that do all the job. For instance, if you're installing a VSAT now, if you want to dig the ground, they won't allow you to bring people to dig the ground. They have people, they call them Prodeco, like an engineering firm. They are the ones that will be responsible for digging the ground. Meanwhile, in Shell, you can bring in people, but you have to follow certain standards. So the organizational structure, the organizational environment, all affect the way your project is being carried out. That is what we mean by project context. So in the course of your reading, you have to, one of the key things that affects the success of your project that you look out for in your exam, in the course of administering your project, is the kind of organization. A lot of questions come out in the exam that refers to, organizational, environmental factors, organizational structure, the roles that the program, the power, the impact that the project manager can have is limited, as it's been limited by the structure. So projects should respect and adapt to the performing organization. That is the policies they have in the organization, the policies, the procedures, they must be followed. And these policies must be ethical and comply with regulations. So as a project manager, your role within the project context is to make sure that the organizational policies you are adhering to comply with government regulations or whatever regulations that exist. And you also must comply with the ethics, the organizational policies must be ethical. Those are the role of the project manager within the project context. So when you hear the word project context, or when they are talking about organizational environment, they are referring to the project context, the environment within which the project is organized. And so we, following up on that, we have different types of organization. There are quite a number of different kinds of organization, but in the exam, the major things you'll be seeing, there are three major types of organization that you will be coming across with, the broad category. There are some other ones, but you rarely see them. While reading, you will come across them, but in the exam, you will see either you see a functional organization, a matrix organization, or a projectized organization. And what do you mean by functional organization? That means that organization is structured in a functional way. The way they arms, they run by departments. You can have a department of engineering, department of accounting, department of safety, department of this, department of that. The organization is not structured in a way, they are not targeting project. They are working based on the expertise of each individual. So that's why if you see experts in engineering or engineering people will be grouped in a department called engineering department. Accountants or people that have to do with finances will be grouped in a department called finance or accounting. So that's a functional. And in any functional organization, the functional manager or the departmental manager is the one in charge mostly. So because he's the one in charge of those resources. Resources here refers to the workers, the people. For instance, the manager in charge, or let's say the engineering manager or the head of engineering will be in charge of resources like engineers. For instance, in my office now, we have departments like we call them, we have someone like the front end manager. That means the front end manager is manager of all the front end developers. Front end developers have their own departments. The back end developers have their departments. So manager, the backend manager is the manager in charge of backend developer. So if there's anything happening that requires a backend developer, it's the backend manager that would determine the way the backend developer works or the kind of work the project can work on. So in such an organization, the functional manager is the one that is controlling the way things are going. Determines if there's any project that is to be done, is the functional manager that determines the success or the failure of it mostly. You know, then we have another organization, another type of organization called matrix. So the matrix organization has three different types. So we have the weak matrix, we have the strong matrix, we have the balanced matrix. In a nutshell, the matrix is just like a mix of the functional and the other type of organization, which is called projectized. I will talk about projectized organization. Okay, so the weak matrix, let me talk about projectized organization first before talking about the matrix. A projectized organization is just like the opposite of functional. In this case, the organization is structured around projects. Such an organization, you don't have department of accounting, you don't have department of engineering, you don't have department of maybe designers or department of any expert area. What you have is projects. Like in that kind of organization, you can have a group of people, a project, people working on a federal government project. Let's say federal government road rehabilitation. You have a number of people working on road reconstruction projects. They will have another group, like maybe another project. Maybe another project is like a development of a solar power system for Lagos. So the group in such organization is the project that determines the way the teams are formed, not the expertise of the resources themselves. So for instance, in a construction team in charge of construction, you may have an architect, you may have a civil engineer, mechanical engineer, an electrical engineer, you have an accountant there, you can have a safety person. The same thing. In the same company, you can have another project, another team that is handling solar project. In that team, you still have a mechanical engineer, you might have a civil engineer, you can have an architect, you have a builder, you can have an electrician, you can have the same kind of setup you have in the other project. So the organization is structured around projects. So that's a projectized organization. And in such organization, the project manager determines the success of the project, because it's a project manager that will be in charge of that team handling each project. And it's that project manager that will determine the resources, the needs, and how the resources are used. When I mean resources, most times it's not only maybe gadgets or tools, physical tools. It could be human beings are also resources, you know. So it's the project manager that determines the project resources utilization and what happens in a projectized organization. Then we now have a matrix. So a matrix is like a mixture of functional and projectized, but the mixture most of the time doesn't come in, is not balanced. That's why we have a weak matrix, a strong matrix, and a balanced matrix. So a weak matrix is whereby we have a functional manager, and the functional manager is strong. It has more influence than the project manager. So in a matrix organization, we have both the project manager, we have both the functional manager. But because the company, sorry for the background noise, I'm outside somewhere. So in a weak matrix, the functional manager, there are still departments and there are still projects. So in that case, the functional manager holds on to his resources, the people working under him, whereby the project manager will rely on the functional manager to release resources to him to execute any project. And in such a place, with such a weak matrix, the project manager does have next to nothing. He's not even, he doesn't have power, he can't do anything. He has to be running around to beg the, you know, departmental manager that, please, I need people. You understand? So then we have a strong matrix. A strong matrix is an organization whereby projects are prioritized and the departments. In such a place, the project manager is stronger than the functional manager. Yet the functional manager might be there, might be one controlling resources, but whatever the project manager says, the project manager doesn't need the approval of the functional manager in such cases to draft resources to meet a project. So that's a strong matrix. Then a balanced matrix is where they both share equal power. That is, they have to work together. And this is one of the biggest sources of headaches for project managers. They are always at loggerheads. In your exam, questions also come up most of the time around conflicts. They can ask questions like, when they are painting a scenario and they tell you that a project manager is having challenges getting resources on a project, they cannot ask you, what kind of organization is that? You know, they will just describe a scenario whereby the project manager is trying to get a job done and is having issues with getting resources to go to execute a project. And they will tell you, what kind of organization is that? That's how they set their question in PMP. So for you to understand that the project manager is having a problem, you definitely know that that is a weak matrix or a functional organization. So that's how, those are the types of organization. Like I said, these are just explanations to terms that will be coming up. You'll be coming, as you read on, these things will be getting more clear. I hope you are following. So as a project manager, we have project managers' management skills. Project manager, like you said, the manager is managing something. That means there are certain management skills that are very essential for the project manager to have. You know, a project manager needs these skills in order to successfully lead a team to execute a project. The first thing is leading. Leadership skill is key. The project manager doesn't have leadership skills, it's going to be difficult for me. I don't know how he wants to cope. Leadership skills are key to project managers. Communication skills, in fact, in the PMP exam, they tell you that communication is like 95% of what the project manager does is communication. Communicating with stakeholders, communicating with the team, communicating with senior management, communicating with the client, sponsor. You know, communication is just the bedrock of everything that project manager does. Another skill management skill is negotiating. The project manager must be able to negotiate. And when I mean negotiating, it's not only negotiating price, you are negotiating for resources, you are negotiating with stakeholders to get their buy-in, you are negotiating with the government or the enterprise, you know, you are negotiating with everybody. So it involves a high level of negotiation. So another key skill is problem solving. You must be proactive as a project manager. A project manager is one that, you know, looks at problems and fix problems because you are there. That's the work of project manager, to fix problems that are arising in the course of executing a project. Another key skill is influencing. Project manager must be able to influence both your team, must be able to influence your other departmental managers, all stakeholders. You must know how to, you must have an influence. And when we're talking about influencing, there are different ways of, you know, having an influence. You have an influence by having a good relationship with someone. You know, when someone trusts you, when someone is able to commit himself or trust you that you are leading them well, that's a level of influence you have. So influencing is a key skill that a project manager should have. These skills I listed there will still be something that will still be broken down as you read along, just for you to understand it. Then another context, another terminology that you'll be familiar with here is project governance. And when we're talking about project governance, we are talking about how a project is being governed, how a project is being coordinated, kind of how a project is being arranged, how the project is being overseen. So project governance looks at how project is performed. It ensures projects are executed the right way. It ensures that project governance occurs throughout life cycle of a project. You know, well, basically what project governance is all about supervising the project itself. And this time around, supervising the project and the project manager. Because project governance ensures that projects are executed the right way. It's the project manager that is actually in the heat of executing the project. But the project manager needs to execute projects in a way that matches with the organization's policies and meets with ethics and standards. So project governance are the things responsible for making sure the project goes the way it's supposed to. And there's project governance in play throughout the life cycle of a project. Project governance may define the processes used across the project and the rates and rate the project manager's performance. Basically, the project governance we are talking about is the project management office or the project office. This is the office that determines, you know, how the project manager runs his project. So it's referred to as the project management office. You very definitely will be coming in contact with project management office a lot during the course of your study. Then the project manager may formally report to the project management office. Notice that I underline may, because sometimes it doesn't happen. Sometimes an organization doesn't have a project management office. It's happened. Sometimes they don't have a project management office at all. So you need to take note of it. Sometimes they are not responsible for defining, you know, the projects and the processes that projects go through. Now, it's sometimes project governance or the project management office solely exists to support and help the projects, you know, manager. Sometimes, like I said, organizations don't even have project management office. So you need to take note of, and these things I'm taking note of, what I'm trying to explain them, because questions in PMP will not ask you direct questions. Is your understanding the test? So they prepare, they give you case scenarios. For instance, let me give you an example now. In the exam, they may tell you that in a project that a project manager is going through, is organizing, is executing a project, and it needs help, you know, or there's a body that is making sure that the project is carried out properly, that is auditing the process. And they may now be asking you that, what kind of, you know, organization, or what's the name? This question is I'm just crafting a question off my head. Don't expect to see it. But what I'm saying is that instead of asking you that, what is the project management office, they will describe the situation of what the project management office is doing. And they will ask you, what is that? You understand? Or they may ask you that, who are the people responsible for ensuring that projects are executed the right way, or ensuring that the project manager executes the project in the right way? So you have to know that definitely is the project management office. Of course, from the options they will give you, you will have seen it that project management office, they will give you some other conflicting options. So you have to take note of that. So that is art about project governance. Then the next thing I want to talk about is project life cycle. Basically, the project life cycle, the phases a project typically goes through. You know, all the phases, like if you remember the first part of this particular slide presentation, I talked about phases, which are the stages a project, kind of stages that a project go through. So a project life cycle is those are the phases a project, the entire phases from, for instance, the building a house, we have a foundation laying phase, we have the block work phase, we have the roofing phase, we have the electrification phase. So for a project, the project life cycle is all the phases from beginning to the end. That's the project life cycle. And this project life cycle shows the expected flow of activities. When you say project life cycle, it should give you an idea of the activities as it goes on. For instance, once you hear the foundation laying, you know, that should be the beginning. When you hear the block work phase, you should have an idea, okay, after foundation, maybe block work, roofing. So these phases give an idea of what is going on in the project. I need to drag this video. Okay, so then we now have what we call a triple constraint. This is another terminology that is very key. Triple constraint. And this is very important because here we are really going deep into what project is all about, project management is all about. So in project management, it follows the law of nature that, you know, in nature they said there's no vacuum. They said in nature there's no vacuum. Why do you say? Because if you have water in a box now, and the box is tightly filled up with water, if you have to push your hand inside the box of water, some water has to spill out. And that is what the triple constraints concept is all about. There are three basic things that usually, these triple constraints, they are usually referring to the cost, the project cost, the project scope, and the project time. These are like three constraints that these three things must, you know, they have to be considered. If one is like three of them have spaces allotted to them in a project, or they have their quota in a project. And just like I said, if you have to make one big, one of them, one or the other two must shrink. For instance, if cost increases, is either the scope reduces or the time reduces, or both scope and time reduces. If costs will reduce, that means scope as in scope will either increase and time increase, or both of them increase. The same thing with time. If you try to take away time from a project, that means scope is increasing or cost is increasing. So these three things go hand in hand. They are constraints. They always affect one another. It's just like I know some of you must have had this statement when they said, how do they put it again? If it's fast, if anybody can remember, let me say when something is either quick, if you want it fast, then you won't want it good. If you want it good, then you don't want it fast. You can't want it both fast and good. It's almost like that idea. So when you're talking about constraints in projects, you consider the cost, scope, and the time. Then also, it's expanded beyond these three things. The quality and risk are often now considered as part of constraint too, you know, because the fee, it is in project manager is believed that quality also is affected by scope, time, and cost. So for instance, if you reduce the cost of a project, there is every tendency that the quality of the project will reduce too. If you increase the scope, for instance, if you suddenly decide that you are no longer doing ABC, you want to do ABCDEFGH, and the time doesn't increase, there's every tendency that the quality will reduce in order to accommodate the scope. You understand? So, and also the risk too. Once you are changing cost, there's a very high tendency that you are affecting the risk. So the idea of the triple constraint in any project or in any question that you are seeing is like, when they are talking about cost increasing, scope increasing, time increasing, quality or risk, they are saying that check the impact of that item, of that parameter that you are increasing on other things. For instance, you are running a project, you are working on a project to install a satellite system for a company. And then suddenly the manager or somebody in the company just tell you that, maybe initially they allotted, they gave you like, let's say the project will cost like 50 million. And suddenly they came up and said that we can't spend 50 million again. You need to do this project, we'll do it with 30 million. The first thing you do as a project manager before anything, note this, the first thing, this question always comes out in PMP exam. First, what's the first thing you do? That question is very technical. It's only a very common question. There's no way you write to your exam. In fact, I can say like 60% of exam will be like, what is the first thing you do? What is the first thing? So in any situation as a project manager, whether in your exam or in real life, when you are asked that a change should happen to the cost, like I said, it said suddenly tell you that you should reduce the amount of money they are going to spend from 50 million to 30 million. The first thing you do is to look at how does this change affect scope, time, quality, the risk, and every other thing in the project. So you first of all evaluate the impact, and the evaluation of the impact will now determine your response to the look. Sometimes when they tell you that we are reducing budget, and you look at it, okay, if you drop it at 30 million, then that means instead of doing this project for 5 weeks, it will take us 10 weeks because you have to do it at a slower rate. We use lesser number of people. The resources will drop, you know. Or you might say, okay, it might be a scope that they change. Maybe they said initially you are just supposed to install a satellite system. Now they're saying that you have to you have to be the one that will install the power, the power supply that will power the solar system. That means the scope of the project has increased. So that means the cost, you now go and look at, okay, if you are going to install the power again, that means we have to use more resources. That means the cost will increase. So these constraints always happen. And this is one of the key areas where questions are built in a PMP exam. They will always ask you, what should you do? And anywhere you see what you do, the first thing that should come to your mind, like this situation that happened, what impact does it have on the project? So you go back and look into the project, how does it affect the quality, the time, the scope of the project? Which stakeholder, in fact, to the point that it even affects the stakeholder, you cannot say, okay, before you are executing a project in let's assume you are building a road. This is a road project for now. You're supposed to do a 500 meter road. Suddenly they tell you that the road, the 500 meter is no longer going to be 500 meters. It's going to be 1,000 meters. That means the road will extend into some other people's land. That means the stakeholders now has increased. Some people's land that were not touched before will not be touched. Now, if you are working on 10 people's land before, and now increasing the land you are touching to like 15, that means 5 stakeholders have been added. Communication channel is being added. The number of people you have to communicate with will increase too. So this is projects. A lot of things just happen once the project scope changes. So, or once the project or any of these constraints are touched. So triple constraints, note that is a very key concept that will see you through projects right from the exam into handling projects in life. So so those are the terminologies. Another terminology that we need to mention is project management methodology. So when you hear methodology, I think I mentioned this on the earlier one of the classes or videos we had. Methodology is talking about basically how something is done. The method by which you apply. Now, take note, if you remember, I mentioned that there are 49 project management processes according to PMI, according to PMBOK, we have 49 processes. And these 49 processes are grouped into 5. You have initiating, we have the planning, executing, monitoring, and controlling, and the closing. So, but these processes are not the method. They are processes, they are not methods. You can be using a particular process. You might be following a particular process with different methods. For instance, you have 2 football clubs. The process of organizing a football match is the same thing. The referee walks into the field. They have a kickoff. The players, anytime the ball enters into the net, is counted as a goal. If you kick a player, you have a foul. These are like processes with which the program, the football match goes on. But the method, the style of play is like the method. You also know, they always say Arsenal, before, I don't know of now, it's like the backslided. They will say they are tiki-taka, passing, good passes. Passing is very well, like Baka, they have a style of play. As against Chelsea, there's a time, Chelsea, they will say that it's rugged, defensive kind of play. So they are using different methods, but the same process, they have to follow the same rule. That is the way methodology. So in project management, we have different methodologies. Like we have the agile methodology, we have Scrum, we have Waterfall, we have different ways of methods of executing projects, which will be dealt with later. And these methods are determined by the organization. Goes back to what I said earlier when I was talking about organizational structure. The organization determines the kind of methods they prefer. Just like a football club determines the kind of style of play that they want to use. So the same thing goes for project management. Then we have the next terminology I want to go to straight is work authorization system. The work authorization system, which is WAS, is a part of project management information system. It's like the system that is used. If you remember, I mentioned that project management information system doesn't have to be tech, doesn't have to be a computer thing. It could be form, it could be the forms that you use to administer a project or to collect information. It could be a certain procedure. So this work authorization system it ensures that works get performed at the right time at the right sequence. So when a work authorization is issued, it's saying that this work will be carried out at so time, in so sequence. This will be done first before the next one. An authorization might say, okay, go ahead with digging the ground or foundation, or go ahead with clearing the land, go ahead with installing ACs, go ahead with installing solar panels. These are authorization system, and that's work authorization. It could be as simple as an email. It doesn't have to be something complex. It depends on the organization. organization system is a part of the project management information system. And that is the end of this aspect of terminology. So after now, in the next class or in the next video I'll be doing, we're going to be talking about the tools, ITTOs, the inputs. We're going to be taking the processes. If you remember in the first class, I talked about processes. And these processes are made up of inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. So we're going to be going to that in the next video. But for now, this is where the end of terminologies, you know, basic terminologies. We're still going to be talking about common input and tools, but I don't want to put them, those ones as, they're part of foundational concept, but they're not terminologies. So I believe we've been following me, and I'm sure we have one or two questions as regards what I've spoken about before I move to the next stage. I have two things. The other thing we need to do is just a kind of motivation, but something that is key to do. So we can unmute our mics to make comments or ask questions. And yeah. Hello, are we still here? Are we here? Oh?
Yeah, I'm still there. Okay. I don't have any questions.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much for the presentation.
Okay.
I just want to maybe like a suggestion. Okay. If, for example, you were emphasizing on some stuff around the triple constraint that you talk about, the cost,
yes,
of time, and some other things like quality and risk.
Yes.
I want to, probably if you could come with a typical exam question so that we'll have be able to follow along how it can come out in the exam. I think it's better for us like that.
Okay, no problem. I'll be doing that. Let me even see if I have any questions.